Dámy a pánové, já jsem velmi rád, že se po roce opět můžeme setkat na sympoziu Philips Česká republika. Dnes máme takový atypický formát, ale o to více vzrušující, protože tématem je Advanced Imaging in Structural Heart Disease Interventions a budeme se živě spojovat nyní s vlastně Philips Experience Center v Eindhovenu a budeme mít prezentace těch nejnovějších technologií právě pro strukturální srdeční onemocnění.
Are we okay? Can you guys hear us?
Yes, please start again. Yeah. We can hear you.
Yes. All right. So let's try and see if we keep connection. So as I said, we are in the showroom with our Azurion system. And this is a ceiling mount gantry, which is a new robot arm, kind of a robot arm, which we introduced to our market last year. We go for ceiling in any setting, in a cath lab. Later on, we will show you tools in hybrid space where we combine fluoroscopy imaging with echo imaging as an example. And the whole purpose of having a ceiling mount system is to have that head and side free. So in daily life, when you have a structural heart case, you would have your echocardiologist, your anesthesiologist working from head and side. So he or she have to have that free space around the head side of the patient, right? So we have a unique solution, which is a ceiling mount flex arm that has a carrier that moves in a rails, horizontal arm, and then you see the C arm itself, right? And this is a unique position actually with that only a ceiling mount system can do. Yeah. This room, as you can see, is rather large. And in this case, we decided to have what we call a parking position at the head and side, left side of the patient. Every room is different. So you could actually mount or define your parking position anywhere in the room that you like. Yeah. We call the system FlexArm, and we call it FlexArm for reasons, right? So in this case, you have all the space around the patient to actually start preparing the patient. And with one push of a button, we can bring the C-arm from a parking position into a working position, right? So we select a work to park position and we want to have the system at nerve side. So with one push of a button, I will go from park to work position. Head and side remains free. So you see in a predictive way, the whole system comes back from a parking position into a working position. One push of a button, head and side remains free. Yeah. So the patient, if it went under general anesthesia, your anesthesiologist have all the space around the head and side to work freely. Now, to move the system around, actually the whole purpose of the flex arm is that you don't move the patient anymore, but you let the system move around the patient itself. Yeah? So with one control button, which I will show you on a simple user interface that is the same throughout the whole Azurion platform, we could move the whole system head to toe. Yeah? In this case, I am using an OR table. The same principle would work with a normal translucent table that you would use in cath lab. Yeah? Because we have that unique arm from the ceiling, I could also move the whole system lateral. Yeah? So my head and side remains free, and I actually have all the space to move my system to the right side of the patient. So for example, if you want to do radial for the right arm, without moving that C-arm to the other side, you could move the whole system in a lateral position. The same, of course, would apply if I would move it to the left side. Normal systems will have a working position at 90 degrees, where the system is now, at 0 degrees or at plus 90 degrees. And actually, our flex arm can go beyond 90 degrees and actually could move to 135 degrees. And imaging can be done anywhere. In this case, you actually free up more space on the other side of the system, because I can bring my C-arm further away or closer to the table base itself. Yeah. And again, free up space on the other side. So there are no compromises from you, you know, in respect to the procedure. No, the system will adapt to the procedure that you are working on. But bring it back to closer to the head end again. I'm going to rotate and going to move it to the head end side. So I'll stop at my predefined working positions. The C-arm itself really moves intuitive. A lot of movements from the ceiling, but you don't mind because the C-arm is here and my patient is here. With my access controller, I have a full stroke of 2 meters and 36 centimeters in lateral directions. You see how much space I have now around the patient again from the left side. Or if I bring it to the other side, the same I apply, you know, to the right side of the patient. This room, as I said, is rather big. System also fits in relatively small rooms. Yeah? So we have different type of grill lengths, different type of configuration, so that the system fits in the room that you have. But the way it moves flexible, that's really unique. Right. If you would have a floor mount system, you're less flexible. If you have a traditional C-arm, also less flexible. Just to show you the control unit, it's really simple and easy to operate. I'm going to take it from the table and just to show you. Yeah. So this is the control unit that we have. Yeah. So it's really simple, easy. You see a few buttons. If you work with Philips before, you will recognize shape of the buttons. We have a philosophy of each button having a different shape. So you actually feel where buttons are being used for. And then you see some buttons, let's say with a functionality, and each button will have their own unique functionality. Easy, simple, and straightforward that you can mount on three sides of the table. To move the whole flex arm inside the room, this access controller. So it's just one access controller designed to move that whole system, that whole flex arm system, flexible in the room in a predictive, easy manner. Right? So all the movements are predictable because the way you put in your mind how you want to move that system, that's the way you move it around. So if you want to rotate this access controller, I can rotate. You can move it longitudinal. You can move it in lateral directions. Remains easy, intuitive. Yeah? So this is one controller that you could actually move on three sides from the table or on the table. And then the second one is our touchscreen module. So the Azurion has been designed for ease of use and workflow improvements. With the new release, this is actually a multi-modality touchscreen module. So more and more is integrated on this touchscreen module. What you see here, and I want to take you through some of the apps which are installed on this multimodality TSM. And the first step that you see here is my X-ray acquisitions. So my X-ray acquisitions are my X-ray protocols that you see here. I could change frame speeds on the fly. And these protocols that you see here, we can really customize per physician or different procedure cards. So the whole system is based on procedure cards, which automatically set up the right system settings defined by your procedure cards. Yeah? That will generate a standard way of working. Now selected the PCI procedure card, so I have X-ray protocols for a left coronary, for a right coronary, cardiac swing, which is a unique swing movement for coronary diagnostics. Instead of taking your standard, you know, angles, you do a swing around the patient, where you could have all your diagnostic angles in just one sweep, saving you contrast and saving you dose in the end. And a third actually provides you more information because it builds up a kind of a 3D model of your left coronary and of your right coronary. These are my X-ray settings, collimation. We are all used to manipulate images on a mobile phone or on a tablet. Why not do exactly the same on a tablet that you control in the cat lab, right? So collimation, you can do it traditionally with the buttons on the control unit, but why not use our fingertip to collimate and to bring in shutters and wedges? Because actually all the series that have been taken from this patient are on the touchscreen module, as well as live fluoroscopy. Yeah? So all the imaging that you do are on this tablet. So all the series have been taken with this patient, from this patient, actually on the screen. I could even zoom in. Right? So the whole zooming, and we're all used to manipulate images with two fingertips, right? To zoom images, to see detail. We do exactly the same on our multimodality TSM. If you want to copy images to your reference monitor, you have your 1, 2, and 3 here. So the whole imaging manipulation, similar to what you are used to on your mobile phone, but now in the cat lab. You can do on-the-fly processing on your clinical images. I have a marker tool here, so I could quickly draw, you know, a marker of an area of interest which remains in space. So if you mark it on an acquisition, and in that same position as you did your markers, or you added your markers, and you would use fluoroscopy, you would still have these markers as an outline. So whole processing of images is done on your multimodality TSM. Last one, also important one, is my SIAM and table positions. So I can store unlimited positions of my SIAM in combination with my table. We could build predefined acquisition angles, right, for your diagnostic angles, which we can, again, pre-program, couple to the procedure card to really customize the whole system to your preference. And just by one step, you see there is a link between the selection that I make and my touchscreen, sorry, and my control unit that shows an accept button to actually move that system step by step to the different angles to really guide you and help you in your workflow. As I said, it's a multimodality TSM, so a lot actually is integrated on the touchscreen module. One example that you see here is IVUS imaging. So instead of having a separate control unit mounted somewhere on the table or being wheeled in, why not have it integrated on your multimodality TSM, which we do. Yeah? So the Philips IVUS imaging and the Philips IFR FFR pressure measurements are included in the multimodality TSM, saving you one additional control unit, you know, being mounted on a table to remove clutter from the lab as much as possible. The other one, which I want to show you here, is my FlexVision. So the FlexVision is the large monitor inside the examination room. Maybe to start with, right, if you treat pediatric patients, instead of looking at all the signals on the monitor, which might frighten the patient, let them relax with comfort teams. Yeah? So you have, in this case, the chicken walking around, or you could select the fish, which is swimming around. So the patient is more relaxed when they enter the room. Different layouts are possible on this FlexVision. So a default layout will be coupled to the procedure card, so that the right sources will be displayed on the right source where you want to have it, with the flexibility to change. So you have different sources here, and here you can change content. Content means you can connect any source that has a video output to our FlexVision. And to display it, it's really simple. So all the sources which are connected, you see in the menu here. And it's just a matter of drag and drop. So you take a source, intrasite, and you just bring it in. If you want to have this image full screen, you press one button and make it full screen. So it really helps you in workflow. You are in control at the table. Because this is one, just to show you the intrasite. Because what we also have is a mouse keyboard here. So I have a mouse here, which is now hopping over a third-party computer, and I could control my intrasite here with the Philips Azurion user interface. Yeah. So instead of leaving the examination room, you get scrubbed, you get into a sterile environment, and you stay with the patient throughout any source that you have. And to show you how far we can go, this afternoon, I also connected my own laptop, so my own PC, and I just took the video output from my laptop and a USB port to take over mouse and keyboard. So if I go back to my FlexVision settings and I drag in my own laptop, I see my TSM now and I see myself. But from here, I can again go to my mouse, which you see here, and make it full screen and start sending messages, for example. Or I could go online and browse my computer. So the whole purpose for this is maybe not the best example, but you can imagine if you would connect your PACS or your hospital computer. So instead of leaving the exam room, leaving the exam room to the control room to get access to any computer, you do it inside the examination room. So your procedure goes faster, you are in charge, no sterility breaks. Yeah? So in the end, more procedures to be done. And more is integrated here. And that's also where I want to hand over to my colleague, Maarten Heij, who will take you through some advanced imaging, because also that is controlled from the multimodality TSM and integrated on the multimodality TSM. Maarten, floor is yours.
Thank you, Eric. So what I would like to show you is two applications, what we have available in the structural heart disease area. So we have the heart navigator, and we have the echo navigator. The heart navigator is the fusion imaging of CT dataset, previous acquired CT dataset, but you can fuse with your X-ray imaging. Echo navigator is the fusion of echo images with X-ray imaging. So let's start with the first one, and I will make the screen big. Stand over here, Albert. So let's start a little bit from the beginning. So the heart navigator is working on the IW, the workstation of Philips, what is connected to the Azurion system, what Eric just showed you. So what you can see is all the patients that are imported into the IW, the workstation. And for today, I will select the left atrial appendix closure. And so you can see over here, you can see the CT data set, what is imported. So it is a previous acquired cardiac CT data set. And I can open this with two different types of heart navigator. So the first one is heart navigator structural heart disease. And the second one is heart navigator TAVI. So that means that is a dedicated workflow for the planning and diffusion of your TAVI procedures. So let's quickly look at that one. So it's now opening the CT dataset, and it is automatically segmenting based on a model-based segmentation, the aorta, the aortic valve, the left ventricle. We also have five markers. So we have two yellow markers. They are the lowest point of the leaflets, the nadirs. A blue marker, what you can see over here, is the inferior border of the left coronary. And the red marker, what you can see over here, is the right coronary artery. And you can also appreciate the automatic segmentation. And you can see very nicely the calcification, what is located on the aortic valve and on the mitral valve. So I can really look where the calcification is located, where it is located in the left ventricle outflow tract, where it is located on the aortic valve. And over here on the top left, you can see the five workflow steps. So the first one I just showed you, that is the automatic segmentation, where you need to verify, you need to check that automatic segmentation. And of course, you can make adjustments if you like, or if the segmentation is not correct. You can also adjust the markers, that's also possible, and you can adjust the calcification. So the second step of the TAVI is the automatic measurements. So why do we need to verify that automatic segmentation? because the automatic measurements are based on that automatic segmentation what we just have done. So we will get the distance of the inferior border of the left to the NLS. By one click, I go to the right, I can see the distance. I can also make small measurements adjustments over here, of course. The LVOT measurements, perimeter area, also of the NLS. And again, if you want to make adjustments also on the measurements, you are able to do that, and it will also update the measurements. Another nice feature is the free center line. So I can scroll here along the aorta and stay perpendicular, and I can stop where I would like to see the measurements on that specific point. So now we know the calcification, we know the measurements, and what we also have is the optimal anatomical planes, what you can use during the procedure. So over here, we have a view perpendicular on the aortic valve, where I can rotate along that aortic valve. And in principle, this is the S curve. And you can appreciate on the top right, you can see if you go to, in this case, LEO 25, caudal 12, you will see this when you fuse your CT images on top of your X-ray images. And nice thing is that you can store those angles, and just by one press on the geo module, just what Eric also did for the recalling the positions, you can also recall those angles. What we also have is a virtual device library. So we are working with a couple of vendors together. They provide us the valves, and we implemented those valves into the Heart Navigator. And you can use those valves to check if it is matching your anatomy. If all the planning is done, you can create a report, a planning report, and you can send this report to your archiving system or your hospital information system. Now I want to stop here because I want to show you the structural heart disease part, where I will also show you the diffusion of CT imaging on top of fluoro imaging. So I already have done some pre-work. So if you open the CT dataset with structural heart disease, you will get an automatic segmentation of the whole heart, also including the mitral valve. So if you are planning mitral valve procedures, replacements, valve in valves, the Heart Navigator can really support you. So I can quickly show you how it looks. If you have a whole heart segmentation, you can really see all the tissues of the heart. And actually, I already did some pre-work, so I will take out now this part. And I will switch to already. So if you do an automatic segmentation of the whole heart, we don't do an automatic segmentation of the left atrial appendage. Because of the different morphologies, it is very difficult for the system to find the right left atrial appendage. But you can easily add segmentations yourself. So I already did that. So I will select the left atrial appendage and the left atrium. And now I can rotate around the left atrial appendage. But you also can see, I also placed the marker over here. That's the marker for the transeptum. And I placed the marker also on the ostium of the left atrial appendage. And with Heart Navigator, you can also create lines. So you can create a line between the ostium and the transeptal puncture. And that line can support you with the guidance towards the left atrial appendage. Of course, this is an example. You can also use it for transapical approach for TAV procedures, of course. Another nice feature is the anatomical planes. So you can see here multiple anatomical planes. So I will select, for this case, the left atrial appendage. And the system goes automatically to almost the right NPR planes, where of course you can rotate yourself to find the best projection, and then you can also do different kinds of measurements. So the measurements what we can do is angle measurements, polyline measurements, and polygon measurements. So for example, if I want to measure over here, zoom in a little bit, the orifice, I can select here the polygon measurements, and just by clicking around, I will get my measurements. And a nice thing about those measurements will also be available during the live guidance part. So let me show you that. So the planning is now done. Imagine that the patient is on the table, and now we have to merge that CT data on top of the X-ray images. So for this case, I will select, it also plays in this case an pigtail in the aorta, so I will select that one, and I will select an injection in the left atrial appendage. So we need to have two images to align that CT volume on top of the X-ray images. So what I can do now is I will select the aorta over here, I will take out the left atrium for a bit, and I can align that volume. So I'm looking at both images. I align that CT volume on top of the X-ray images. Okay, let's say this is acceptable. Now I go to the live part. And for example, where we inserted the device already, the watchman. So you can see the marker of the transseptal puncture over here. You can see the line what we have planned. You can see also the measurements, so the of the ostium, what you can use. And also pretty nice is if you now move your C-arm, that model will also follow. So if you want to look more straight, more perpendicular on the ostium of your LEA, for example, or your TAVI or your mitral valve, it doesn't matter. You can rotate and the model will also follow the CR movements. Zoom in a little bit. And there are different kinds of renderings. Oh, it was a Dicom store. Over here we have different kinds of renderings. I mean, you can change your opacity, of course, and that is in principle the heart navigator. So heart navigator is really the planning of previous acquired CT data set. You can do the planning, you can do the measurements, and then also use the same CT data set as guidance during your procedure. Okay, for the next step, I would like to go to the echo navigator. And I will show you the echo navigator on the big screen as well. But first we go to the EPIC. So the EPIC CPXI, that's our latest ultrasound system, needs to be connected with the Azurion system, what Eric showed you. And that is done by only one cable. So you need to plug in the cable. We call it the Afidis smart cable. You need to plug in that cable. You need to plug it in the wall connection box at the rear of the FlexVision or at the wall, and then the connection is set. And of course, power. If you can see the, normally you will see over here your diagnostic images. So you start with your diagnostic images, color Doppler, measurements on the ultrasound. And by one click, so I click both buttons simultaneously next to the trackball, I switch to the echo navigator mode. So that's what you see over here. So the images on the echo navigator are now also the same images what the interventional cardiologist will see on the FlexVision on the big screen. And that also makes the interaction between the echocardiologist and the interventional cardiologist better because they are looking at the same images. Now, let's go to the, so you can control and view the echo navigator from the EPIC. So the echocardiologist can control the echo navigator, and the interventional cardiologist can really focus on the patient and on the procedure. So let's go to the echo navigator. So you already noticed that it's looking a little bit similar as the heart navigator, what I already showed you. So we as Philips, we really want to focus on the same UI, the same look and feel for all the applications. So again, on the side, so here on the side, you can see the layout. So we have different kinds of layouts where you can select. We have different views. We can place markers, I will show you. And of course, we have the echo images and the X-ray images together, but not linked, not merged. So on the right, you can see the X-ray images. So you can see very nicely, clearly, you can see the puncture needle. And on the left, you can see the soft tissue information, the echo information. But wouldn't it be great to combine the two so that you have real X-ray images and real ultrasound images on top of each other? So based on the head of the TE probe, what we are using, so EchoNavigator is only compatible with the TE probe, we can, by pressing the fluo, we can automatically detect the probe and also follow the probe. And now we know where the probe is in the X-ray or patient area. We can, by one click, I can fuse in real time the echo images on top of the X-ray images. So you can see now very clearly the soft tissue. You can see the puncture needle. I can, of course, change the opacity. And everything is real time. So let's go to the puncture. So the puncture is now done. And you can also place markers. So you can place markers on different areas, of course, but we always need to place the markers in X-plane or in 3D. So I place the marker over here. I need to check if the probe is green because everything is working with that TE probe. And now I can accept the marker. So I have my real-time imaging. I can take that off, but I still have that marker. So let's make it another color. That it is more visible, yellow. Okay, so now you can see this marker. So the marker is now placed where we have done the transseptal puncture, and it gives you also guidance how far you are in with your catheter or your device into the left atrium. So turn on back the fusion. And now let's continue with the procedure. So we can also place markers on the circumflex artery, so over here. And we place a marker on the pulmonary vein ridge, over here. Again, need to check if the probe is green, and I can accept the marker. So actually, you place the markers in the echo space, ultrasound space, and by accepting that mark, you take that marker out and place it in a kind of box above the table in the patient or X-ray space. So now we have three markers and we have the fusion. So let's go to the next case. So you can see the wire. The wire is now in the pulmonary vein. And you know that it is in the pulmonary vein because it is above this marker where we just, this marker we place at the left superior pulmonary vein. So the wire is in the pulmonary vein. And now you have a kind of football goal. So two markers. So the markers between, that's showing you the ostium of the left atrial appendage, where we can advance the device towards the two markers. So let's go to the device. So here you can see the fusion, the two markers, you can see the left atrial appendage a bit. And of course, if you move your C-arm, you will also get a better fusion imaging. So everything is also related to that C-arm projection. So for the left, for the transseptal puncture, we know if you go to a more LEO view around 30, 40 degrees, we know then you have a beautiful fusion image of your transseptal puncture. So your echo images and your X-ray images. If you want to see better the left atrial appendage, you have to go with the C-arm to a more REO view with your C-arm. So you can see that they're advancing the device towards the left atrial appendage. What we also have, so this is the 2D imaging, but of course we can also have 3D echo imaging and fuse those on top of the X-ray. So now I have to wait a couple of seconds till there's an X-ray. It's all recorded data, so. So what we see over here is now a slice out of that 3D image. So you see, can see very nicely the mitral valve. So I can also change from 2D to 3D and change the opacity. And everything what you see again is real time. So this is real time echo imaging, real time fluoro X-ray imaging. Now we are in a LEO position with the C-arm, but if we are moving, and that will happen in a couple of seconds, if we move with the C-arm to REO, you will see that we have a very nice view of the left atrial appendage. Let me click here, over here. So you can also use the fusion images to, the real-time fusion imaging to place the device. Next to the real-time fusion imaging, we also have the heart model. So I will take out now the fusion, and I will turn on the heart model. So the heart model is working similar as HeartNavigate, but HeartNavigate is working with CT dataset. Here we are using the 3D echo volume. So we need to have the aortic valve, the mitral valve, a little bit of the left ventricle and the left atrium in the field of view. We need to have a nice heartbeat because it is moving along the ECG of the ultrasound or anesthesia. And you have to do a proper registration of the probe. And in sake of time, I skipped that part, but it will take a couple of seconds. So what you can see here is the heart model. So I can change, for example, I can take out the aortic valve, I can take out the right atrium, and now I've only visible the left atrial appendage. You can see the ring. That's also part of the heart model of the ostium, and an automatic marker that's part of the heart model as well, but is automatically located on the left superior pulmonary vein. So we place just a marker ourselves. You can also use the heart model to get those annotations, those markers. Again, we can change the opacity, of course. And how are you going to use those heart models? So again, they are working with, if you move your C-arm, the heart model will also follow. That's also something what you see in the image. We are now in an LEO position. We look more in a surgical view on the ostium of the LEA. But if we are going in an REO projection, what will happen in now, then we are looking more straight, more perpendicular on the ostium of the LEA. Of course, this is really focused on the LEA procedures. We have procedure type selection, so we have a bunch of different kinds of structural heart disease procedures. So if I, for example, take the mitral valve, I can turn on the mitral valve analyze. I will take out the left ventricle, and now you can see very nicely a ring around the mitral valve, including the mitral valve markers. And of course, if I change the layout, and you are really flexible, so it's the same as with the flex arm system, you're also flexible with the UI, so what you would like to see. So we make the echo images, we make them big. On top, we have the heart model, and over here, for example, I can also switch and select another X-ray, and I select the real-time fusion. So I have a combination of real-time fusion, my heart model here on the top, and the real-time echo images that's coming from the Epic. Okay, looking at the time, we are 5 minutes before four. Maybe there are some questions.
Both excellent presentations, it was perfect. We have here some questions. The first one is the image integration with MR, because we need also for some structural diseases the MR images like late gadolinium enhancement, for example, for ventricular tachycardia, catheter ablation, and other procedures. What about this image integration?
Yeah, so we have also a couple of applications that are working with MR data. That's the vessel navigator. That's working with CT data and MR data. Unfortunately, the heart navigator, what I just showed you, is only working with CT data. But we know that vessel navigator is also used a lot.
Works on the same principle, eh? So you take DICOM files MR, you import it into our workstation, into our IW workstation, and from there you do the same segmentation phase as Martin just showed you.
The next question is coming from a colleague asking about the possibility of image integration with the nuclear cardiology data, because this is also very important for viability and other data we have. Do you have any possibility in this field? Data from SPECT?
PET CT.
SPECT CT.
No. Not with live, let's say, fluoro overlays. No.
No. Okay, because this will be just a need from a clinician's point of view for the future. So this should be also developed, because data from those imagings are also very important for the strategy of the procedures. Yeah. Another question is coming, ICE, intracardiac echocardiography and image integration, because I, as an electrophysiologist, I use frequently the ICE plus X-ray plus CT, etc. So are we able to connect all those data together? Because this is important for example, AFib ablation in a very complicated structural heart disease patient, etc.
So ICE, we are also working on that, and it's definitely also an area where we are looking into. Yeah, for sure.
You should please.
Not there yet. Eh?
Not there yet. Yeah.
But it's again. Wish from the clinician's point of view to the development centers. So there are colleagues from Philips Czech Republic, so they like to ask you, please feel free and ask.
Yes, I have some ideas what actually could be a good question, because watching the presentation, I think it's pretty much clear that the platform itself is really open. Yeah? So that means that we are prepared for the future, for new technology which might come. And this perhaps might be the question, what we have got, or what we are working on now, what might come in the future, like force and this kind of things. Guys, can you elaborate a little bit on that?
Yeah, I think you said, and these kind of conferences, although it's virtual, I think we also learn from feedback from our customers in Czech, right? I know that our product manager, who is running the structural heart program within Philips, is also in this meeting. So I definitely know that he makes these notes. The team in the US from Philips is working on ICE, on the ICE catheter to be integrated here. And we keep on working on the improvement these parts, yes. So FORCE was one example where we work on fiber optics. To be placed in catheters where you can actually do imaging without any X-ray, but using the catheter as a guidance. So there is no, let's say, threshold to stop innovating, right? working on next releases of the Echo Navigator release 4. Like you say, maybe we need integration with PET-CT. These are things that we work on. And of course, yeah, getting more and more into our system. And what we show today, I think, is already quite unique, right? So the image fusion with Echo that Martin showed you, with live Echo and live X-ray is still unique. Yeah, the integration that we have with our multimodality TSM just to remove clutter from the table as much as possible and really have it integrated in one control unit, having that live image on the touchscreen module, again, something unique that other vendors don't have, and really help you in understanding the workflow, understanding your needs, and try to implement it as quickly as possible.
Guys, one step further, and my question is towards using the holograms and working with the images, because it's very promising for the clinicians working with these holograms and working with the settings of different imaging we have. So are you planning, are you working on this?
Yes, I actually already have a few sites in clinical use to fine tune this. It's still in an innovation phase, I must say. So we work very closely with Microsoft on this. And so my idea is indeed to have the monitors in front of you. Yeah? So you know exactly what's going on. Or having virtually the control unit, which is now a hard-coded or hard-buttoned system that you need to move around if you have to go to the other side, implemented in the HoloLens so you can actually move around and move it virtually. Yeah. Yes. So definitely something we look into that will hit the market in a few years from now.
What about the CT and MR machine combination?
Also that we are looking into. So we need to understand really the clinical needs. So far, we see the combination of angio with CT, where one machine is most of the time on idle. We have software packages on our machine where they can actually do a cone beam CT. Yeah. So instead of transferring the patient to the CT scanner, you do the CT with the angio machine. So in that case, you know, you buy two rather expensive machines where one system is more or less just in a standby position doing nothing and eating dust.
Yeah, this will be ideal for the structural heart diseases. Let's say atrial fibrillation ablation, because in one step, I will have the CT as the first one, then I can do diffusion with the X-ray, so I don't need to move the patient. I can plan immediately in one step the whole procedure. This is very good for the accuracy, for the safety, for, let's say, X-ray dosage reduction, and etc. So this is also a very important question coming here from the colleagues. Azurion platform, what does it mean in the terms of X-ray dosage reduction?
Also there we made big steps. Eh? So one example is the image fusion, where we save dose and we save contrast. We have something which is really unique, which is called Clarity IQ, which is a unique combination of hardware and software with clinical proof, where we managed to drop the dose between 50 and 85% without any loss of image quality. So we can all, you know, lower dose as much as you can, but then there's a trade-off with image quality. With Clarity IQ, we managed to drop the dose with clinical evidence, so clinical proof. More than 15,000 patients were actually part of this study and publications that we have. 50 to 80% less with similar image quality, especially
that's
that last part, I think, is very
and
important.
Significant. Thank you very much. So yeah, the colleagues from Philips, Czech Republic.
Maybe to take one step back and come back to the structural heart. Martin, you also briefly mentioned mitral valve. And we all know that mitral valve and tricuspid, it's a heavily discussed topic for quite some time already. But, you know, do you think that it would make sense that companies like Philips would, you know, create some direct partnership with companies that make, that are making these kinds of devices? Maybe, you know, give us the opportunity to tailor some specific application that would, you know, support specific device or specific procedure.
Yeah,
beside.
What I showed you now, that's really focused on the left side of the heart. So we are talking about left atrium, the mitral valve, aortic valve, that kind of procedure. So really the left side of the heart. Of course, we as Philips, we also have to look at the other side, at the right side of the heart. So for the tricuspid and the pulmonary valve. So we definitely are also looking into that area. Secondly, we also working very closely with the device companies. So what I showed you in HeartNavigate, we already have their templates. We are using their templates in our application. So we have a strong relationship with them. We're also talking with them about improving the workflow based on the device and a combination of imaging. So what are the best angles to use, for example, for EchoNavigator? What is the best way to show the device with less scatter, that kind of thing? So we are really working closely together with those device companies. Yeah,
this will be very important for procedures like Tendyne. This is a hybrid procedure combining the cardiac surgery approach and the mitral valve placement with the new form of a valve. This is a very, very big issue at the moment. But then this will be solved in a year or two, and then you have to come to the right side because tricuspidal valve will be again the next focus for this structural intervention.
Yeah, next focus. Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Thank you very much. We are at the end of the symposium. It was grateful. We will follow you, and we'll have another education in this field. Thank you very much once more to Eindhoven. It was a great hour with you, and we are very happy to hear about the new innovations in Philips. Good luck. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.